This is the fourth ArtAids exhibition that we're having here in Barcelona, and it's a very special one. It's different from the other ones because in this exhibition we wanted to show what has been done in the 80s and 90s when there was so much aid activism in the arts world. We're talking about General Idea, Felix Gonzalez-Torres, Robert Hujar, and many other, Nan Goldin, many other artists, that out of a rage and out of despair made works of art saying, listen, something has to be done to stop the AIDS epidemic. And we wanted to contrast that with the work of artists from now. That's why we commissioned three artists, Willem de Rooij from the Netherlands, Keren Cytter from Israel, and Eulàlia, Valldosera from Catalonia, to make a work inspired by AIDS. And you can really tell the difference. The older works have a lot of urgency around them, while the works made now are more contemplative, more serene, and perhaps even more aesthetic.
Bueno, tiene Veraicon tiene varios registros. Uno es la presentación, que es la videoinstalación, en que planteo que en la manera en cuando miramos la pieza, la ocultamos, ¿no? Porque la pieza viene de una fuente de luz. Todo el dispositivo del cine es una fuente de luz que proyecta en una pantalla. Y esa pantalla es un trapo que está simbolizado por la Vera Icon. La Vera Icon es la imagen que sostiene Verónica en su manto. Y significa que es la única imagen existente de Cristo y es el mito fundacional de la representación, ¿no? La primera representación hecha o que ha ocurrido mágicamente, es decir, sin la intervención de la mano humana, ha sido este trapo, ¿no? De alguna manera es una creencia que invalida anteriores creencias o mitos del nacimiento de la representación. Una videoinstalación que muestra una acción. La acción ha sido inspirada por la relación que he establecido con un seropositivo que mantiene esta realidad en total anonimato y de su testimonio ha nacido la necesidad de crear esta acción en la que un hombre se enfrenta a una estatua sagrada. Es un paso de la Semana Santa que muestra a la Verónica, que es un relato que no existe en los evangelios digamos, convencionales, sino en los apócrifos. El hombre está limpiando la imagen como un acto de, digamos, elaborar el sufrimiento.
Session or something like that, and there is one narrator talking to the public. There is several repetitions of words, as it's supposed to be an hypnotic piece. I think it was also important to film the ocean. In the opening scene, there is one part when the camera is getting all the time farther, and there is an eye test board, and the eye test the text. The words on it are like the meaning of HIV. like what HLB, the initials mean. So it's also, I try to put some reference for the reason it's made of.
Waking up to the sound of the waves. Your mind is an island. You are facing reality by yourself. Relax. Concentrate on the screen in front of you and face your own reflection. In the next 10 minutes, you will experience a temporal loss of memory. In the next 10 minutes, you will lose your country, language, thoughts, friends, hobbies, and family. Let my voice lead you through the images.
It's just like I saw the word ocean is repeated many times in the movie, so I thought it's good to title it Ocean. I think becoming an ocean that is such a huge mass on one planet, it's mean like be connected to all the things that are scaring you. That's it. I think it's a very optimistic one. There are no hopes in the future for the movie, so it's not pessimistic or optimistic, but I think it's very relaxing. I mean, the music is relaxing, and I think the views are relaxing, so I don't think there is any reason to be pessimistic.
Signs in the sky, but I did not know. I'd be caught in the grip of the
world. I've been making flower pieces since 2002, and the piece that I produced for this exhibition, it's the 10th flower work, and it's called Bouquet Number 10. And all these works exist out of a couple of components. There's a description of how this piece looks, and there's a list of flowers. There's a certificate that is part of this work. So when the piece is not installed in the way that it is now, it actually exists only out of a number of pages of text. And that is also one of the things I really like about making these flower works, that they have the capacity to be absent. If they're not installed, they're also not there. But I've seen a piece like this in a documentary made by the Romanian filmmaker Andrei Ortica. In this film, there's a number of archival images of public ceremonies in the time Ceausescu was still ruling in Romania, the communist era, and there were quite a number of flower arrangements that looked a little bit like this one, made out of red flowers within the middle, one white flower, so obviously this kind of arrangement had a particular significance in the socialist state that Romania was at that time. For me, I did not set out to make a work that comments on communism for this exhibition, but I did think of the role of the individual within the collective, and that's how I came to this particular form. One very direct reference to another work in the exhibition is the white lily that also features in one of the photographs of Robert Mapplethorpe that is on show in this exhibition. And I chose that white flower to be a lily because of the other piece that is in the exhibition.
The idea is really to have people talk about AIDS exactly the way we're doing now. AIDS, HIV have become invisible, very different from the 80s when so many people who were sick were walking around and so much was talked about HIV. That's no longer the case. It seems to be something from far away. And we want to use the exhibition as a talking piece for people to realize that AIDS and HIV still exist, that they have to take care, and particularly that they shouldn't exclude people like me who are living with HIV. In the 80s, as I said before, artists were crying out, AIDS is here, something has to be done. And something was done. There were scientists, there were doctors who decided to work in HIV. I was privileged to know one of them, Yuflang. He was my doctor. He took care of me. He saved my life, as he saved millions of people's lives through the projects he started in Africa and Asia. Yuk and his partner Jacqueline were both interested in a variety of things. They weren't your typical doctors who can only talk about their own field. They were interested in music and in art. And of course, they were very much looking forward to being here today. It was on their agenda. However, it was not to be. On the 17th of July, on their way to Melbourne on a flight, on the way to Kuala Lumpur, the plane was shot down and they died, along with hundreds of others. There are many things to say. It's a great loss for humanity, it's a great loss for all of us living with HIV, and it's a great personal loss for his family, for myself. And therefore I'm particularly happy that his children are here, his sister is here, and that's one of the reasons why I want to dedicate Perfect Love to Hugh Lange and Jacqueline Fontaine.